just wanted to give you guys a quick reminder. If you guys love my videos and want to support me, check out compassion-tees.com. Link is at the end of the video. All right, this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and you're like, John, where the heck are you? Well, I'm here in Mesquite, Nevada. So why is it Mesquite? I don't know, maybe the mesquite tree, or it gets super hot here, and maybe they have some barbecues too in the summertime, I'm not sure. But it's basically on the border between Nevada and Arizona. It's super hot area, maybe like the same temperature as Las Vegas, so it's pretty hot. And then maybe add a couple extra degrees, because it's literally out here in the middle of Mojave Desert. And where I am today, I'm glad to be at my friend's place. This is the home of Ronnie and Minh. You know, and if you've been a long time viewer, right, you'll remember that I made two episodes of Ronnie's and Minh's before. So check the links in the description below if you haven't seen the videos I made here, where I give you guys a tour of their nice little garden in one video, and then the other video I made about like how to keep cats out of your garden, which, you know, Ronnie came up with this ingenious idea because he gets neighborhood cats and the cats roam around and he keeps them out of the garden so they don't use it as a litter box. Nowadays, actually, I saw that he has actually a cat trap, and if he catches cats in his trap that are just wandering around, he'll take the animal control. So, but anyways, the reason for this episode today is because I want to show you guys the best raised bed you guys should make to have basically almost zero maintenance-free, and have the easiest time gardening and growing food ever in your entire life. And, you know, Ronnie's always up to different gardening, farming projects. Besides having his little residence here, he has actually a farm in Arizona just down the way that he manages, takes care of. He also has one of the boxes that I'm showing you today over there operating in full sun, where he's had tremendous success. And that's why I want to make this video for you guys to share with you guys the success. You know, if you live in Vegas or in a hot desert climate, you probably want to only build this kind of raised bed or this style garden instead of a traditional one. So first, I actually want to start in Ronnie's traditional garden and explain some of the pros and cons of a traditional kind of raised bed garden style. And then we'll flip over to the new style that I want you guys to get into these days in times of drought. All right, so this is a traditional raised bed garden that you guys might see many videos about. This is a pretty simple one because he's basically just got some 4x4s laid on the ground, above the ground, filled it with some good, you know, a soil blend, and he's growing stuff. You know, this bed does not actually have an irrigation system in it, so that means that Ronnie comes by every day with his watering hose or watering can and basically waters this to keep it nice and healthy and growing. He's got some beets and some chard. It's been getting kind of hot in here. And, you know, basically the plants are now dependent on him for the water. He waters once a day, right? Whether, I don't know, maybe sometimes if it's like wet in the winter time, he won't water. But most of the time in the summer, he was there once a day. Maybe if they needed a nice spritz in the middle of the day, they're not able to get water, in my opinion. You know, plants, they respirate, you know. Like, we perspirate to kind of, like, keep us cool. They respirate, so they basically pull water up from their roots, run it through their little cells, and then evaporate off their leaves to kind of stay cool. He does put a shade cloth up, you know, certain times of the year to help keep them cool. But I think maybe water in the middle of the day might be good. But you know what? Who has time to do that? Ronnie, you know, has two different properties he's managing, taking care of. He has a grandkid. He has all kinds of things going on in his life. He loves playing music. He doesn't want to sit and tend to his garden. So he's doing some research online, and he found a new style of raised bed that he built that's virtually maintenance-free, and he literally doesn't have to, aside from building it, he basically does nothing except harvest the vegetables that he's grown out of it. So let me go ahead and show you guys that one and explain it next. All right, so what I want to show you guys next is this. And this is called a sub-irrigated planter, or SIP, S-I-P bed. You could call it a self-irrigated raised bed if you want. I mean, it looks like a raised bed to me. And this one, he doesn't water, but look at all these greens, these nice little greens. They're called ha, or actually for English speakers, called Chinese chives. So, you know, they're really mild kind of onion. Like, I'd love to just pick these. I'd love to have this much of the ha so I could just literally pick it and eat it as a salad, because when you pick these literally it looks like blades of grass, but these are like onions, and eat them, they have a onion-esque flavor, but like they're super mild. They taste like a lettuce flavored onion. Wait, does that make it? Does that taste like lettuce with a little onion flavor? Super mild. I love them a lot, and they are thriving in here, as have other greens that he's grown, mustard greens, collard greens, in this sub-irrigated planter. So how this works is you got to build it once, and then he has his automatic sprinkler system come on every day, and it waters it at the spout over there. You guys see that over there? It's basically a PVC tube with a funnel on the top, and he has a drip line going to it, and basically it just waters in there. And you're like, John, how do you know it's not going to overwater? Well, that's because right here, if you guys can see that on the camera, there's a little tube that comes out. And this is the overflow tube. So the water goes in there, and if it gets filled too much, then the overflow just comes out right here. And so it could never get overwatered. And basically how this works, this is a raised bed lined with plastic. You might want to use some kind of pond liner because the plastic, you know, may degrade over time. So it's basically like a fish tank. Think of it, it's like water tight. The water does not run through. It's made with three layers of 2x6s. And on the bottom of this, it's not open to the ground. It has a piece of plywood down on the bottom. So they basically built this, literally this box, or if you think of it as a coffin. He lined it with plastic so that it's basically a waterproof on the inside. It'll hold water. Then he popped a hole in it, you know, just a few inches up to have that drain tube there. And then in the bottom, he basically has a 4-inch black style drainage pipe or irrigation pipe, you know, the ones that actually have the holes in it. And he has those running the length all the way down, maybe like 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe like 5, all the way down the bottom. Then he's basically stuffed gravel down in there at the bottom, about the height of the PVC tubes at the ends, and then maybe halfway down the middle. And then up the rest of it, he basically just put a potting mix, not a potting soil, but a potting mix. So that's like a soilless growing medium in there. And basically what happens is he waters it, it fills up to a certain level. And so there's always maybe 2 inches of water at the bottom as a reservoir. Then there's maybe like 2 inches in those PVC tubes as like a nice air space. And then there's the gravel in the bottom where the water is also sitting. And then it has the potting mix that then can wick, or literally, you know, wick up the water from down below and bring it to the roots above. In addition, the roots, guess what? They are water-seeking missiles. The roots will find their way down the water and grow. So in this way, like this bed, I think, has been maybe going on like 2 years now. He's been quite successful growing the ha in here, and that's what him and his wife like. They like the ha, so they just have a whole bed of it. But, you know, you could easily grow other greens in here. You know, maybe not all plants will grow well in this style bed, but many will. You know, I've visited and seen many sip beds. I'll post a couple links down below. Let's see, an aquaponics farm that I recently visited had sip beds. They're growing root crops in there. Local farm in Southern California basically had all these self-irrigated planters. Once again, link is down below. They're growing basically hydroponically. And it's just growing really well. He also has these little, he puts PVC in here to basically cover this. And basically, you know, in the summertime, he could put shade. He could put bird netting over it if he's seeding it so that the birds don't eat the seeds. In the winter, he could put plastic over it just to keep it a little bit warmer. I guess I want to go over a few more finer points on this sit bed. And then actually, we're going to sit down with Ronnie and where he's going to share his experiences with you about his amazing sit bed, the easiest way to garden in a raised bed. All right, so I want to share with you guys more about the sip bed. So basically, if you're using some kind of like a potting mix that's a soilless mix, you're probably asking, John, how are the plants going to get the nutrients? So, you know, even though it's a potting mix, there's still definitely some nutrients in there. But just to make sure Ronnie's growing some high quality food, he's adding some liquid nutrients. No, they're not, synthetic nutrients. He's using organic nutrients. The labels ward off this, but basically this is some fish emulsion. You have to take my word for that. Instead of fish emulsion, I would encourage you guys to use fish hydrolysate. The brand is Pure Protein. It's basically enzymatically extracted instead of heat extracted. So there's going to be more nutrients that are more bioavailable and absorbed easier by your plants. And then the other thing that I actually like more is the seaweed extract. So liquid seaweed extract to make sure these guys are getting all their trace minerals and they're doing great. I mean, of course, if it was me, I'd probably add other things like rock dust and try to add maybe just some worm castings and do some compost tea on the top. You know, get a nice microbial environment going on, but that's probably beyond the scope of this video because Ronnie's not doing that stuff. He's just trying to keep it simple and basic and easy, right? And this is where he basically puts the water, and he's got like a cheap funnel, and this is how it gets water. He just got a dripper here that he could turn off and on, and he just sticks that in there, and it goes on, and the water goes in, and everything gets watered. So, I mean, it's really, gardening is that simple, right? Probably the main expense is building this and the time it takes to build this, right? I think he took maybe like a half a day or a day to build this, get it all together. And I think he invested probably about $100 in all the materials, the construction materials, the plastic, the wood, the screws, all that stuff to put it together. And then he probably added maybe about another $50 in the soil, you know, mix that he's using, the soilless mix. And so he's basically in it for $150. And check this out, right? He never has to buy Ha or the Chinese chives again. He's basically set, him and his wife are set for a life with growing chives. So whether you want to set this up with chives, whether you want to set this up with your favorite herb, your favorite vegetable, right? Think about it. If you buy $150 worth of food, right, you eat it and it's gone, right? Poof, it disappeared through your body into the toilet bowl. But if you invest $150 in like building a raised bed, you plant seeds once, right? This crop right here grows year-round in mesquite, you know, despite 110 degree summers and despite 26 degree winters, right? 365 days a year, he always will have these greens to eat. So I don't know what better investment you guys could make in your health or your wealth, all right? Best investment you can make is grow some food. So I want you guys to do that. The sip bed is definitely the way to do that. There's many videos on YouTube on how to create one of these guys. And I mean, my goal is to maybe, I'm gonna convert half my yard over to sit beds from my standard raised beds because I think it is just the way of the future. Besides, you know, being easier to maintain, besides being self-watering, you know, they conserve water more because the water's, you know, in there, you're not getting all the evaporation loss from watering on the top. So that's also amazing in these times of drought and water restrictions, depending on where you live. Then the last thing I wanna say is that, you know, I want to basically get an IBC tote, so then I don't have to use the wood, I don't have to use the liner. I basically just chop it in half, and then I can make two sit beds, one with either half of the IBC tote. So hopefully look for a video upcoming when I do that project, because that's just going to basically make it a lot easier. He has like $100 in the materials. I think an IBC tote could be $50 to $70, depending on where you live in the country. Chop it in half, add the soil, a couple, you know, drain tubes and plugs, fittings, and you're done. So it's gonna be super easy, super cheap. Thumbs up if you want that video, and leave a comment down below to let me know that I should be making those. Maybe that would get me out my tushy to do it. I guess last thing I want to do is we're gonna head and interview Ronnie, the guy that built all this, put it together. He's growing this way, and he's totally convinced that this is the future of gardening, especially if you live in desert climates. So now I have the pleasure of introducing to you guys Ronnie of Ronnie and Minh, his better half, or his other half, sorry Ronnie, and at their place. And you guys just saw his new sit bed. We're going to talk to him more about the sit bed and what you guys should know about the sit bed. So Ronnie, how long have you had that self-irrigating plant or self-irrigating raised bed in production? And yeah, let's start with that.
Well, I've had this one for 2 years now. This is the second season of full production. And the one at the farm preceded it by a year. So I've been doing this now a total of about 2.5-3 years.
Cool. And so why did you choose to build this style raised bed, you know, instead of just a standard raised bed?
Yeah. Well, because the biggest challenge here that I've had is growing really good greens, collard greens, mustard greens, the ha, lettuce. And I found after researching and look around that this really had a promise to be something that would really grow this stuff good. Because my wife and I use the greens a lot in wraps and salads. It's pretty much a staple. And to be able to grow them fresh and healthy. So we tried this out and we had so much success with the first one that we did at our farm, we decided to come over here and start a second one.
Cool. So the greens just grow a lot better. So I know you grew collard greens in your standard garden bed this year and they weren't able to, you know, do super well, but they did in your in the self-irrigated planter at the farm, right? You want to talk about this, and why do you think that is?
Sure. Well, I think the problem that all gardeners come up with against is that we're trying to mimic nature. We're trying to water when we think the plant needs water, and it's pretty hard to second-guess plants, and every plant needs something different, and every year you're presented with different weather and different challenges. But with the sub-irrigated beds, the plants go down and find the water themselves. Then they take exactly what they need, no more and no less. And that's the beauty of this, is that no longer am I making the decision about how much water my plant should get. The plant's making it, and nobody knows better than nature. And so the plant is really just taking care of itself.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I would totally agree with that. And, you know, we try to micromanage our plants. Like, I'm going to give it this much water. Maybe it's too much. Maybe it's too little. You know, I want to have a video in the future talking about, like, water requirements of the plants, right? Basically, if you ever play darts and you're throwing darts at the dartboard and there's, like, that bullseye in the middle, that's like if you water it exactly right, you're hitting that bullseye, which is, unless you're a dart expert, it's pretty hard to do. But, you know, then you got the outer bullseye, and even, like, you could win the game even if you kind of, like, make it in the outer ring if the other guy misses, right? So even in an outer ring, right, you're giving maybe enough water for the plant to live but maybe not thrive optimally. Whereas in this system, you know, let the plant determine how much water it wants to suck up. Now, that being said, I will say that maybe some plants may not do so well in this system. So also be open-minded to that. Some plants like more dry periods where it's not maybe always constantly wet. So then you could maybe, you know, tailor how much you fill that guy. I mean, that's a whole nother discussion and topic. So, Ronnie, I know you had really good success with greens. Any other comments or, you know, things you'd like to share about the sit beds?
Well, just that it just seems to be an easy way to do it. It's a natural way to do it. Again, the plants get what they want. I think that is it's optimal for the greens, for leafy greens. You can have some success with other things, but in the general rule is things that take a longer period of time, like tomatoes or like zucchini or something like that. You can still grow it, but you won't have the same type of success that you will with the leafy greens, because the leafy greens are the number one thing that grows the best inside these sub-irrigated beds for my climate. Now, that could be different in another climate. You know, it could be totally different. But for here in the desert where it's hot, where watering, the amount of water, the time that you water, the consistency of water all makes such a big difference. When the plant can make all the decisions, it just works out better.
Yeah, I agree. And the other thing is, you know, if you guys have never been to Vegas, as soon as you step off that airplane, if you've never been to Vegas, like, you get dehydrated. Like, water is evaporating out of your skin. If I go to sleep at night, wake up in the morning, probably got to drink an extra 32 ounces, at least 16 ounces of water to replace what's been evaporated off of me. So that's happening to the soil, that's happening to the plants really fast in arid climate zones. I mean, and some of you guys might live in South Florida, Hawaii, and Arkansas or something, and you guys don't understand the arid climate here. And this prevents, poses some really big challenges, especially for some plants that really like a lot more humid, right? And so I think this is a solution, to help that along. The other thing that's really exciting to me about this raised bed, or the self-irrigated raised bed, is how much time it takes once you set it up properly. So Ronnie, how much time does it take you to dedicate to watering this bed, or basically doing anything to it these days once you set it up and built it properly?
Virtually nothing, because I've got it hooked up to my automatic sprinkler system. So when my sprinkler system goes on in the morning, it fills the bottom of the bed with water, and then all day the plants take whatever they want. I literally just walk by and take a look. I take a look to make sure that there's no bugs or cats or wind damage or things like that, and then so I might have to do a little something like put up some shade cloth or put up some bird netting. But basically I just walk by and look at the plants and make sure that they're still healthy and everything's fine. And there is literally no work to this. Once you've got the whatever you're planting in there, you got the water, it's gonna take care of itself until you're ready to harvest it.
Wow, yeah, I mean, it's literally set it up right, minimal work, come and harvest it. So this is like the perfect thing if you guys have a 9-to-5 job, you're out of the house all day, you're working all day. You could have this on automatic irrigation. You could come back and have your greens. You know, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, and it's not called Growing Your Greens for any old reason. It's because I believe that greens are the most important food on the planet, and by fact, actually, they're the most under-eaten food on the entire planet, too. So above all else, I really want you guys to focus on the greens and the herbs, the leaves that you guys could eat, aside from being the easiest things to grow, they're the most nutritious for you, that most people unfortunately skimp out on in lieu of grains and meats and other things. So eat your greens, most important food. So Ronnie, we're coming to the end of this episode. Or any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share, you know, as a farmer, as a gardener who's been growing food and eating a healthy, plant-centered diet now for over 20 years?
Basically, you summed it up really well. The only thing I just would restate is that when you grow these greens, the collard green, the mustard green, the lettuce, all these things, the nutrition, and you'll notice it in the taste. You might not notice the nutrition, but your body will, but you'll notice the taste, the difference between what you're getting in stores. I don't care if you go to the most expensive, best store anywhere and it says organic and this and that, it's not going to be the same as what you grow at home, because it's not going to be picked at the same time, it's going to be warehoused somewhere. There's going to be all kinds of steps in between planting and eating that you won't have to go through at home. And nothing is going to beat these plants that you grow yourself. You know exactly what's in there. And I agree with you 100%. Leafy greens, I think, are the key to a success with a vegan, a vegetarian, or a raw food diet. I think leafy greens are...
Or even a paleo diet. I mean, whatever you're dieting on, you need to eat your greens. I don't care if you're, you know, whatever you eat.
I think it's one of the...
even a junk food diet, you got to eat more greens.
Yeah. So I love it. I love it for the leafy greens, the simplicity, and everything that you mentioned.
Wonderful. That's great. Yeah, I mean, once again, I want you guys to grow your food. Take control of your own food system by growing part of your own food. I mean, I'm not to the point where I'm growing all my own food. That's a goal of mine. One day I will move to acreage and have fruit trees and everything I need to eat. But, you know, I'm growing as much as I possibly can in my space. And, you know, I give the tomato analogy a lot. You know, greens that you harvest and pick yourself taste way better in the store. You know, it's kind of like a tomato. You buy a tomato in the store, they'd have no flavor. I just picked tomatoes from my garden a couple days ago, and oh my God, like, that reminded me why I grow my own food, because it's just significantly, the taste is better, the nutrition is better. Fresh pick, you know exactly what was sprayed or not sprayed on it. You know exactly the fertilizer inputs that were used, you know, so you can be in charge of your own food system and your own destiny, actually. So I guess that's pretty much it for this episode. Thanks for having me, Ronnie.
Okay, John, just one more thing I wanted to hit on if we got time, is that another thing I've noticed is that when these plants, because they're getting the water that they want when they want it, and they're so healthy and strong, that they're strong. And just like a person who's healthy and strong, they don't get the sickness that a lot of other people get. And so these plants aren't, the bugs don't want to attack them because they recognize them as a strong plant. So I'm saving money. This is much cheaper than buying in a store. I'm getting the highest quality that you could possibly get because I know exactly what's been put in and what's not put in. And I'm getting the strongest plants that are fending off disease and bugs and everything just because they're getting what they want when they want it.
Yeah, I mean, and the secret to that is when the plants get what they want and when they want it, they basically produce higher levels of phytonutrients and phytochemicals, or just plant chemicals, which are basically the things that keep the bugs away, which then in turn, when we eat these phytonutrients, these are things that keep disease away from us. So, I mean, it's a great system. It's the best way to have, you know, a healthier diet, is to increase the quality of your food. This is a mission that I've been on at least for the last 10 to 15 years now by growing my own food, and you guys could do it too. Hopefully this episode has enlightened you just a little bit. You know, and hopefully maybe causes some perspiration after you start building some of these self-irrigated planters or sip beds, so you guys can start growing your own food today. If you guys enjoyed this episode with Ronnie, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, give this video a thumbs up if you want to do that, project with the IBC tote, making a sip bed out of that. I'm sure somebody's already done that, but that's going to be fun for me, and it's going to be an easy way and, in my opinion, an inexpensive way to do it. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes. I'm coming out hopefully every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or we'll be learning my channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Also, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,400 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, teaching you guys how to grow your own food, high quality food at home. With that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.